Good morning, Trinity. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Isn't it glorious to see the spring? Although with the spring and the sun brings that lovely pollen stuff. So please take care of yourselves. Drink plenty of water, not just liquid water, and keep yourselves well. So we've got so much to celebrate here at Trinity United Methodist Church. And one of the big things that I would encourage you to be in prayerful consideration with is our confirmands. We have a wonderful class. I think we have a couple sitting in the congregation this morning who will actually be on a retreat next weekend. And we pray that they become closer to God our Savior. They're already there, but let's pray that they become closer. There's a lot going on at Trinity. I encourage you to look at your calendar, look at announcements as you came in this morning. I encourage you to participate in all the Lenten activities in the week, especially of Holy Week from Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday. There are many opportunities to share in God's glory. And as we await the risen Savior, I would ask you now to go with me in prayer. Father God, as we enter into this opportunity for worship, be with our hearts, be with our heads, be with our thoughts, be with everything as we concentrate on you in the coming of our Savior on Easter Sunday. Be in prayer, Lord, with us as our confirmands enter into a new stage in their Christian lives. Be with them as they retreat next weekend to learn even more about you and become closer to you. All of this we pray in your most holy name. Amen. Let us worship God. Thank you.
Please remain standing as we continue our worship with a responsive greeting printed in the bulletin or on the screen. Your part is in bold. Long ago, God rescued God's people from slavery.
We are slaves today in many different ways.
God can and will rescue us. Place your trust in God's love. Even though temptations surround us, drawing us away from God,
we will continue to follow God and trust in God's ways.
Amen. Please be seated. Join me in the prayer for illumination. It's in your bulletin and on the screen. Let us pray together. Blessed Lord, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our Old Testament reading of Psalm 107, verses 1 through 3 and 17 through 22. It's printed in your bulletin and on the screen. We'll read this responsively. Your part is in bold. Oh, give thanks to the Lord who is good, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Let us redeem the Lord, say so, whom the Lord has redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south.
Some were sick through their sinful ways, and because of their iniquities, endured affliction. They loathed any kind of food, and they drew near to the gates of death. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress.
He sent out his word and healed them and delivered them from destruction.
Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, for his wonderful works to humankind. And let them offer thanksgiving, praise, sacrifices, and tell of his deeds with songs of joy. May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and living of these words.
Can I have the children come up here with me? Good morning. Good morning, good morning. How is everyone? So, what do we do when we want to talk to God? Pray. Great. Perfect. And when can we pray? Anytime. That's the answer I was looking for. Is there any place we are not supposed to pray? No. Now, I will tell you, there are some people who think and some people who will say, you can't pray at school. But that is not the truth. You can pray at school. You can pray at the park. You can pray in your bedroom. You can pray at the dinner table. You can pray when you go out to eat at restaurants. There's no place that you can't talk to God. Do you think God sleeps? He doesn't. The Bible even says he does not sleep. So you can talk to God any time or day. Doesn't matter where you live in the world, he's always awake. Doesn't matter if it's super late at night and you're supposed to be asleep and you can't fall asleep. Have you ever had that happen? I have that happen. What I do when I can't fall asleep is I start praying because it kind of makes my brain slow down and calm down. And it usually helps me fall asleep. Now, do I fall asleep while praying? Absolutely. But you know what parents think is one of the sweetest things when you guys were all little babies and they used to hold you and you'd fall asleep in their arms because you knew you were safe and you were comfortable and you knew you were going to be taken care of. And I think that's what God feels when we fall asleep while we're praying, right? It's like we're his children. He wants to see us comfortable and to feel safe. And so it's okay if you fall asleep praying, which I feel good for because I'd be in a lot of trouble. I am not a morning person. And so if I have to do, like I've tried so hard to be one of those people, I'm going to get up early and I'm going to do a devotion time and I'm going to pray. And this is me. Halfway through my prayer, I'm falling asleep. So I'm really glad that God loves us even when we fall asleep praying. Can you pray on the playground? Can you pray when you're sad? Can you pray when you're super excited? Yeah, you can pray for all those things. Sometimes we forget to pray when we're excited, and we tend to pray more when we want something or need something, right? Those kind of, I call them genie in a bottle prayers. Dear God, let me have this. Dear God, help me do this. Dear God, but we also need to remember to pray when we're happy. Thank you, God, for this beautiful sunshiny day. Thank you for Easter bunnies. Thank you for butterflies. Thank you for all the good things too, right? And here's the thing. You don't have to know all the big words and the big fancy prayers. Your prayer is important as anybody else's in this room. More important than Pastor Scott's. More important than everybody's. It's just the same, right? You don't have to be fancy big adult with the big fancy words to pray. He just wants to hear from you, right? So we're going to pray right now. Are you ready? Thank you, God, for your love. Help us share your love. Amen. Miss Erica is going to do children's church for you.
Places you could be, Trinity United Methodist Church is where you are today. It is good to see you. All right, I just got to get this off my chest. I certainly prayed yesterday for something good to happen. And that's all I need to say. Okay. We're continuing in our sermon series on the Lord's Prayer. We've gone through 3 weeks. We're in the final week of that. I hope this has been rewarding, nourishing, a great learning experience. You'll never pray the Lord's Prayer the same way again. I hope you'll never look at it the same way. You'll experience it now in a new way. And maybe now you can teach it in a new way by the way you live, and which is what my hope has been all along. So let's go back quickly do a little review to see where we've been, because we're going to be right at the end of the prayer this week. First week, we looked at Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, right? So it's our Father, it's not just mine, right? It's yours, it's ours, all of ours together, that God is there present for us. And the whole idea of that he glorifies his own name, he makes it holy, and then we ourselves then can resemble and do that by the ways that we live. We just help reiterate and shine that, right? So when we sing, when we pray, when we glorify God by the way we live, in his way, we are hallowing his name. Then we looked at week two. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, right? God's kingdom is here now. It is not just going to come in the future, but it is. Remember, it's past, present, future, all at the same time, all around us. And then I think what I liked about this week was that we talked about our daily bread, right? And that if you interpret it and translate it, it can be, let me have tomorrow's bread today. Like, let us celebrate what God's gifts are going to be tomorrow. We can actually have it now. We don't have to wait till we die. We can still have God's banquet now. And we can celebrate and be with God in a whole new way. We don't have to wait for that. Last week, we looked at forgiveness. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Trespasses, debts, sins, however you want to define that. We looked at the whole idea of the vertical dimension, how we ask for forgiveness from God, and then vertical one another, right? And it forms the cross. Very appropriate, right in the middle is where forgiveness happens, right, in the cross. And so that is what we have come to for the fourth week. We're going to talk about temptation and the kingdom power and glory. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. I hope that you will be able to reflect on, you know, times in which you have been tempted. I want you to think about those things. You can think about them during this time or after, as you're maybe reflecting on what the sermon was said, those times that you were tempted and how well you managed that. We're going to read a little bit from Matthew 4 about Jesus being tempted. How does that play into how you yourself manage your temptations? We're going to also look from Luke 22, and we're going to see the disciples and Jesus' understanding of what kingdom and power and glory really means, and how that then, how you define that in the world today. We're going to look at how the end of the prayer, the doxology, the praise part of the end of the prayer, how that has implications into your life. Why was that added at the end? Because that's not in the scriptures. It was added later by the church. And then I hope that you might evaluate your whole prayer life after having these 4 weeks. If you've caught all of it, if you've caught part of it, how is your prayer life now? I hope it's richer and deeper. I have heard from a lot of you who said how this has made a difference in their life, how it's impacted you, maybe the ways you think about the prayer now as you say it, how it may impact how you live, and how you might look at others, and how you see God's kingdom really all around us now, right? Because then no one else is going to see God in the world without the church. I mean, they just aren't going to see it. They're going to see something that's an idol. But they won't see the God of Abraham and Jacob, right? They're not going to see the God of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit outside of the church. The church has to show that. Outside is going to be some version that looks not even like who God is. So it requires us to live and to listen. So let's listen to first scripture we're going to go to today is Matthew 4, verses 1 through 11. Let's hear these words. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But Jesus answered, "It is written, 'One does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, all these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. And the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. Then our second scripture is from Luke 22. A dispute also arose among them as to which one of them, meaning the disciples, was to be regarded as the greatest. But he said to them, the kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you, just as my Father has conferred on me, a kingdom, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. It's the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Now, I can guess what a lot of your questions are going to be about that. And I think the most common question is the one that you're thinking, that the church has wrestled with and has trouble with since this all was actually physically written down somewhere. Why would God lead us into temptation? Why would God lead us into temptation? Some of the early church has tried to kind of water that down, right? To cast a different light on those words. So it doesn't seem like God is leading us into temptation. You know, saying that, well, maybe Jesus didn't really mean to say it that way. And so how do we reconcile that? The modern voices have tried to fix the prayer. One fix may sound like this: lead us away from temptation. A few years ago, Pope Francis declared the wording to be taught, do not let us fall into temptation. The word here in Greek, it's not in dispute. Lead us not into temptation. There's no dispute to the word. You're not going to have anyone. People are just trying to reconcile. How does that come about? Now, if you know anything about literature, ancient literature, they weren't good with punctuation marks, right? So if you're reading the book by Adam Hamilton about the Lord's Prayer, he does talk in there that when we say, lead us not into temptation, if you were to put punctuation marks, there could be a comma right after lead us, comma, not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. There might be. It's not in the original manuscript. In fact, there's no, like you go back and like you can read the Greek and the Hebrew and there's no punctuation. You don't even know where the sentences end and begin. That's why in some translations, you got to figure out what's really being said because it just is run on. So it could mean that, but, and I'll leave us with that. I hope that, you know, it could mean that God lead us and then not into temptation, but think about it as a parent. We ourselves don't willingly want to lead our children into something that could harm them. However, there are things that we need to learn on our own, right? We can't protect our children our whole life. And it's not that it's a bad thing, but that I think what God is saying, look, in those midst of the temptation, I'm there with you. Isn't that kind of what we say with our parents, with our children? Is that though they have to learn on their own, we're there to support them. They may succeed, they may not, but we're going to be there to love them. They may not understand what's going on and why they had to go and do that, but in the end, they're better off for that. You know, you can tell which ones of us have really had to work and figure out how to manage through life. If something's handed to you your whole life, you don't have certain skills because it's always been taken care of for you. And those who have had to grow up early, you have skills that far exceed what your age is. And then everybody else in between. We all fall into temptation. So the idea to try to fix the prayer, I don't know. I will leave that up to you and your interpretation of how you want to hear the prayer. But I do think that God is always there in the temptation, right? He is always present because, as Bonnie said, that's where what we call on God the most, right? When we're tempted and when we're struggling, not when things are great. When things are great, we don't need God. We got it ourselves. All right. Some scholars think, though, that this scripture could be read as the early church was reading it, waiting for Jesus to come again, the second coming. They thought he was going to come pretty quick. And so they believed that they would be under enormous pressure to abandon the faith so that they needed assurance that God was going to be with them, even though they were tempted to give up their faith, even though they were tempted to fall into line with the world, even though they were tempted to go and do things that they didn't want to do, they thought they would be abandoned. How many times has that happened to us? We feel like we might be abandoned. But look at Jesus again. We go back to the Garden of Gethsemane. He prays, what? Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. But then he says, well, not my, but your will be done. Right? So if Jesus is tempted, we're tempted. So that's just a non-negotiating. That's a non-starter. We're going to be tempted. Nothing we can do about it. It's always going to happen. If Jesus is tempted, we're tempted. The deal is are you going to fall into temptation? And so maybe as you hear, lead us not into temptation, as we go into temptation, you know, protect us from evil, but in the temptation, be present with us. Maybe that's what you hear. But I leave that interpretation to you. There's many ways you can hear that. I don't think it's one where it's a punishment, right? I'm going to lead you right into that fire and I'm going to watch you. No, that's not. I don't think that's what God's saying. God's going, okay, here, we're going to go this way, and you're going to go with me. And he's going to walk and be present. The disciples, again, when they fell asleep, Jesus says, stay awake and pray that you may not come into temptation. He uses the words from the Lord's Prayer, the model prayer at that point. In Matthew 26, Jesus is afraid what will happen when the time of trial comes because he will face that. He knows what's coming, but he's already been there. If you look at it after the fact now, he understands. It actually, I think that line echoes the experience of Jesus himself at the start of his ministry. Because what does it say in Matthew 4? Jesus is led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Well, to me, it seems like you don't need the comma. If the Spirit's going to lead Jesus into the wilderness, we're going to be led into the wilderness, and we're going to be tempted wherever we go, right? So I think if we understand that Jesus didn't fall into temptation, so that's the key. We don't want to fall into temptation, but he was led there by the Spirit. These 40 days of Lent that we are in is really that reminder that the life of Jesus is framed by times of trial that he faces. And each one, God leads him and leads him and leads him, right? We look at the Matthew text. He's in the wilderness and he answers every temptation that Satan has coming at him, right? He's able to ward that off. How well do we do? Our temptations come at us in many different forms. I had some fried Oreos and ice cream the other night. That was really good. So if I had to choose between that or a kale smoothie, I think I'm going for the fried Oreos and the ice cream. Now, I can drink a kale smoothie, but it has to be the right thing. If I have the choice, I'm going for the fried Oreos and the ice cream, right? So what's your temptation? We all have them. Right? And so how do we manage through that? So Jesus was able to manage with Satan through all of the temptations that came to him. He says, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Do not put God to the test. Worship God and serve God only. I think if we remember those three ways that Jesus warded off the temptation, that's a great way to live. We live by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Don't put God to the test. Worship God and serve God only. Man, if we did that, the world would be okay. So he's warding off, and that's what the world is telling us. And those should be our answers in the modern context. But we don't always do great, right? We don't always do great. We live in a culture that is fearful. We are afraid all the time about all that's going on. Leads into temptation to define others as evil. It limits the possibilities of how we can provide change in the world because we're afraid of each other instead of loving one another. We arm ourselves with weapons, both real and metaphoric, and we convince that to protect us from what we fear, that always just can lead to violence is the only way. And that's not true because the word is powerful and God's word is mighty. That's what this prayer can teach us. So we don't need violence, but we can use God's word. Jesus teaches us to pray so that we might live with courage in the midst of the difficult realities and the challenging times. Go back and read Joshua. So he takes the Israelite people into the promised land. Be strong and courageous. I write that in my journal all the time. Strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. Right? Strong and courageous doesn't mean that you aren't a little afraid, but not fearful that you're not willing to do anything. Remember, in a baseball world, if you play baseball, to get from first to second, you got to do what? You got to step off the base. That's taking a risk, right? Are you going to make it to second from first? Well, it depends on the play. Depends on the situation. But to get to second, you got to go off to first base. So life is that way. Where are you now? If you want to go from here to there, you got to step off the base. You got to take a risk. But no need to be afraid because you have to know the right play. You have to be in the right situation. You have to have the right coaches and the people around you. Right? And of course, God is going to be our coach. We have the playbook called the Bible and our experience and our tradition and our reason to figure out, okay, how are we going to manage? When we learn that and understand that, we can then step off and go, okay, that's great. Now I can run, right? I can go to second. I can steal the base. How are you going to get home? Wow, you still got to go all the way around from second to third, third to home. It's a long way. So do not be afraid. And I think the prayer, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, is a comfort for us. We don't have to be afraid. When we step off, we have this courage. We trust God and we hold fast to our faith. If you don't do anything more than that, just hold on to that. Just hold fast. The psalmist understood. Psalm 46, 1 through 3 says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult, though more people are coming into our community and technology comes and I don't understand it and I don't know what's going to happen from here to there with my health scare that's coming because I've got this and they've got that and I don't know what to do and oh my gosh. Lead us not into temptation. But deliver us from evil, right? To deliver us, to keep us from. We go into places of fear and we go into times of trial because God is going to be there with us. He's not going to leave you. Now, it may seem that way, and there are times that I don't listen to my own advice either or what the scripture says because I'm afraid too. But the greatest fear I probably ever had was going into ministry. Would I be able to do it? And my analogy is as I'm standing on the cliff and it's nothing but a chasm right below me, like I'm on the edge of the Grand Canyon. And I'm like, God, you're asking me to do something that I can't do. And he just says, take one step at a time. And so you take a step and you don't fall down. It's solid. You can see all the way to the bottom, but it's solid every step. Sometimes you choose to stay for a little while. Sometimes you back up a little bit. But if you trust God, you'll take that step and it's going to be okay. Just one at a time. You don't have to run. Just one at a time. That's what God is telling us. When we go into those times of trials, I will be there. I will not let fear overcome my faith, our trust that God will see us through. The doxology, the praise part of the prayer at the very end, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. It was added by the church, and it's a great addition because we start with hallowing God's name early on. God does that, then we live that way, and now we're also proclaiming glory at the back end. The way that we can hallow God's name is by what we say at the end. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. The kingdom is past, present, future. We talked about that early on the first week. And so here we are talking about it at the end. It's present with us. The power that God has. God's power is not the world's power, right? It is humility. It is love. It is forgiveness. It is grace. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave is right inside of you. It's right inside of you. That's called the Spirit. It's right inside of you. You know that? That's when we know that and can believe that, or on the way to believing that, that's great power. We don't use that power to overcome, but we use it to serve, right? To serve, to kneel down, to wash someone's feet, to take care of those who are in need. You know, Trinity is really, I'm watching that happen. Now, and I'm a part of some things that are happening. There's a group that's working with Epworth Children's Home, one of the cottages with some of the young girls as their intake, the intake into Epworth and the transition. That is going well. We've got Miss Griffin who lives down Boney Road. She's raising her four great-grandchildren. There's a group of us that met the other night. I'm telling you, it is it's a lot of work. But we're not there to save them. We're there to help teach people how to fish, so that they can take care of themselves. But in the midst, we're growing too. We're changing. And as we change, the community changes. As the community changes, God's name gets praised and glorified. And you're not going to find that again outside of the church. If you went to Doko Rib Fest yesterday, you're not seeing God proclaimed there. Jesus isn't the number one name on the list. Ribs are. Right? That has nothing to do with Jesus. The world doesn't like Jesus. They don't care about him. They don't. If they did, where'd all these people go? Where'd they go? There's great power in us. The power of invitation and hospitality and welcoming, and living a way that Jesus taught us in this prayer. And then there's great glory. We can proclaim all the good things that God has done for us. I mean, you know, God has been gracious to us. You know, I can't even tell you the number of miracles that I've seen and witnessed and heard just recently about things that have happened in people's lives. And it's only by God's grace. Someone who was a young guy who was, you know, really not sure he was going to be able to move or dance and you know, move around very well. He was athletic, but got prayed over. And the next thing you know, he suffers no pain right now. He can flip and tumble and move around and do things that, and I've seen video of this and I'm like, goodness gracious. That's pretty awesome. Remember, we have a healing prayer team after the service. They'll meet in the room back here. Remember, all people are healed, but not everyone is cured. Very few are cured. Now, I'm not saying that the young guy is cured. I'm just saying at least this point, he's able to do some things, but he's young. Right? He's young. But God can do great things. So Kingdom, power, glory, and then forever. Right? Forever is one of those words that, you know, there in the world, there is a definitive end. But in God's kingdom, there's nothing. It goes forever. And so this is something to be reminded that all of what we have said lasts forever as well. And then there's one little word at the very end we say, amen. So be it. Why do we say amen at the end of our prayers? Right? I think we say that's kind of the exclamation point. Everything we've said before, let that be so. That's right, God. That's what I mean. Right? So be it. This is it. Everything is all wrapped up into one. So I hope that our time working through the prayer has been very nourishing for you, that you've been able to see it in a light that maybe you've never seen it. You'll never pray it the same way again. Teach people about that what it can mean to you and your family, your life, your world, all of those things wrapped together. Because it is powerful. Church has not done a great job of teaching what we do, right? We need to do a better job of teaching, which is why I wanted to take the Lord's Prayer. It's something that we all say. Remember I told you the story about going to the memory unit over at Lohman Home in Chapin and being able to talk with folks who don't know you from Adam's house cat. But yet, when you start praying and you say the Lord's Prayer, their mouth moves or they say it out loud as well. It is unbelievable. It is unbelievable to watch it because it's rooted in. So for all our children and youth, remember that. Know the prayer. Learn the prayer because you'll say it the rest of your life. It'll be said over you. Remember when I talk about this is where things happen right here? At a funeral, I'll say it over, folks. That'll be one of the last prayers we pray. Is the Lord's Prayer. Say it in the hospital as people are dying. Say it over, folks. I mean, that's powerful. Now that we know, kind of have a better understanding how richness of it, it's not just words. It is the life of God that we're learning how to live in. And it's given to us. I mean, that's free. We'd have to pay for it. And there's no tax on it. It is free. In the coming weeks, we've got some more. After we get past Easter, I've got another series called Be Like Jesus. We're going to learn how to be more like him. We're going to work through some weeks with that. And then I've got some more series that are coming down the road. There's a lot that's coming. We've got to get through Holy Week. I hope you'll be part of that week as the Palm Sunday. In this service, we're going to do a kind of a lessons and carols with the Palms, which I think went well last year. It's a great way that we can sing. We can actually hear the story of Palm Sunday and the Passion, all the scripture read together, because you won't ever hear it all together during that week, unless you come to every service, and then every service doesn't read it all. Like, there's parts that are missed. So we want to hear all of that. Then Maundy Thursday at 7 o'clock in here on that Holy Week Thursday, and then that Friday, Good Friday, the youth will be doing the Good Friday service in the youth building. Be a great opportunity, and then three services for Easter, 7 o'clock at Parks Place, 9:15 in the youth building, 11:15 in here. Just a few things we got going on during that time. That's kind of the pastor speak. That's the gauntlet that you go through, just like you go through Advent. That's not as hard as Easter. Holy Week is very difficult. So that week, I'll probably be pretty much pulled back and focused on getting that week and getting it going. But man, we're going to celebrate on Easter, aren't we? Because it's going to be beautiful in here. And that's where God's glory is going to shine through. And it's going to shine in your eyes and shine in your faces as we move forward. Let's go to God in prayer. Let's pray. Oh God, we are so thankful for this opportunity to gather together today to be your church. Lord, I am thankful for each person in here and online. God, you know, these people love you. They trust in you and they have faith in you that you are going to lead them and guide them in their life. You know their hearts. And you know their situations, both good, bad, and indifferent. You are present already at work, maybe even before they realize it. But God, you've been faithful to us. People have worshiped for generations on this land, in this spot right here. and they will continue to worship for generations after us. And we are thankful that we ourselves get that opportunity to be a part of this kingdom, God, that you have built, you have given us an opportunity to serve, a time of growth to learn about prayer. Lord, we are a church that connects. We do connect with you and others. We get opportunities to speak to people in our community and at events and through our schools and through the stores and shops that we go to, and such that we might be able to grow. Lord, you are growing disciples all around us through all of our small groups, any ways that we gather together in this place. You're growing us strong and courageous so that we will not be afraid, for you are present with us. So then we might go and serve people like Epworth and Ms. Griffin and others in our community that go nameless right now, but one day we will know them by name. For God, we know that that comes with this great responsibility. People are looking at us as the church, and they're just ready to point a finger to say, see, the church, they're just a bunch of hypocrites. They just say what they say and they don't live that way. But that is not how we live at Trinity. Because we are people who care, who are full of love and grace and patience and kindness and self-control. We are ones that want to see the best in others, to give of our time. Lord, give us the strength to continue to do that, for we don't always live up to that. And Lord, we pray that minds and hearts will be moved and stirred by the ways that we live each and every day, by the small things that we do, the twinkle in our eye, the smile, the holding of a door, the saying the thank you, to just being present with someone can really change and move someone in a way that only the Spirit can do. We thank you now, O God, as we thank you for these 4 weeks of learning about the Lord's Prayer. Prayer is important, and Jesus taught us a prayer. And we're going to say that prayer, O God, like we mean it, because it has come to us in a new light and a new way, full of power and glory. So let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. One final caveat about the prayer when we pray that. You know, we're not just praying it for us or for me. We say us. Us doesn't just mean us in this room. Us means us all around the world. Right? So it's a world prayer as well. So we're praying for everybody. When we say that, us means everybody. And so I think that that's really cool how Jesus gave us that and said, all right, go with it. And I hope it will lead you to where it is you want to go and where God is leading us. Let us stand and profess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. And God has richly blessed each of us. So now is our opportunity to give back to God by the presentation of our tithes and offerings. Oh God, we give these gifts back to you, for they were yours before they were ours. We pray that you will multiply them in our presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn 400, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Find that God's peace will go with you. We concluded the service at 9:15 with a great song that was really powerful and really upbeat. If you were in there, you saw me jumping around and dancing around with the youth team and all. So I was dared to do that in here. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to jump around a minute, right? I'm not going to do that in here, right? So, but I got excited in there, and I just wanted to be part of what was going on. So that's a way that we can glorify God, right? We can praise God. We got to be able to show God that we care and that we are here listening and present. So now go in peace to love and serve our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ this day and always. Amen.